So now we have an event on community energy. Community energy to the rescue, local choices, global effects. So I'd like to first of all say, you may be surprised that there's rather a lot of blokes on the stage and not that many women, and I want to say right away, there's a good reason for this, not because women are not involved in this work, but because they're all congregating in Oxford tomorrow morning for, guess what, a conference on community energy. And so they couldn't be here at the same time, or couldn't be in Bristol this evening. They had to host guests coming from far afield. So that's the reason for the rather predominant male presence on the stage. So I'd just like to briefly introduce the topic. And so maybe all know these kind of images of industrial revolution, fires and cities and pollution and lung disease following on from that. So obviously this is an extraordinary change in human history, having fossil fuel technology suddenly come on stream in the late 18th century, and we all know what happened as a result. I mean, urban growth on a massive scale, but also, you know, desperate problems of workers deprived of any rights, massive amounts of coal being transported. This is actually a picture from the Port of Cardiff about 100 years ago. Just extraordinary quantities of coal coming out of the hills that had never been dug into before. It was just astonishing, the transformation that took place there, and where these valleys were really farming valleys with just a few thousand people in these communities in the South Wales valleys. Towns suddenly appeared of hundreds of thousands of people. There's about 700,000 people still living in those communities just in South Wales, and there had been maybe a few thousand before the Industrial Revolution got underway. So, and today these communities are actually stranded in these areas without really significant job prospects, but we'll come to that later on, come back to that later on. So here's just a kind of one image of the amazing use of fossil fuels, but also a bit of nuclear, of course, in the mix, and a bit of biomass. But renewables, as you can see up there, is still a very, very small proportion of the mix, but it's going up very, very rapidly across the world, of course, now, for all the reasons that I'm sure you've been discussing today. But and an even smaller proportion of that renewable wedge up there is actually community renewables. So we have a big job on our hands to really make community energy happen, because really, I mean, energy until now, from the Industrial Revolution, beginnings of the Industrial Revolution onwards, was really the domain of a few people who became extremely wealthy, who exploited in the most effective way huge numbers of miners. And today we have the possibility, with renewable technology, of a kind of new energy democracy emerging, if we are really going to push for this in ways that we have started to, but we haven't done enough about. So the part of the results of the Industrial Revolution and this extraordinary access to coal and gas and oil was the emergence of a new kind of city, which I call Petropolis, city powered by fossil fuel technology. Vast urban systems that had never existed before. In the 19th century, beginning of the 19th century, London was the world's largest city, 1 million people. Well, then it grew to about 8 million people by the beginning of the Second World War, but today it's a small city. There's 20 odd cities of over 10 million people, mega cities, and two or three of 30, 35 million people. Tokyo and Chongqing in China, those are the largest ones, all powered by fossil fuel technology and some nuclear as well, of course. And here's just one picture, and this is, I mean, I talk a lot about cities, but I'm not going to do that very much other than two slides here. Shanghai, Pudong, 1978. That's what it looks like today. Same place. Isn't that an absolutely unbelievable transition? All driven by fossil fuel energy. Anyway, so we have an amazing breakthrough happening in the field of renewable technologies, and some of the people who pioneered this actually on the stage right here, particularly Preben Mergaard from Denmark. So we have tremendous transformation, and I would like to particularly draw your attention to the picture on the top left-hand corner there, because turbines, wind turbines in the 70s were the sort of size of that 50 kilowatt turbine. Now it's 5 megawatts. In fact, it's that already, small turbine, 8 megawatts is becoming quite the norm now, particularly offshore, but gradually also onshore. So an astonishing transformation. Also floating wind turbines now offshore happening, and of course marine current and tidal turbines. And on the right-hand bottom side, there's the idea of storing hydrogen from electricity produced by turbines for tankers or freighters to top up when they go around the world. Anyway, these are utopias to some extent, not very democratic either, I dare say. And then similar amazing breakthroughs in solar technology, all driven ultimately by policy. And this is the important point, really, that is also relevant in the context of community energy. Feed-in tariffs, first introduced by people like Preben and some of his colleagues in Denmark, made all the difference for the introduction of renewable energy. Because they basically was a device to make solar and wind cost-effective in competition with other technologies, such as oil and gas and coal-based energy technologies. But even today, you know, where these new opportunities arise, the main investment comes not from the communities, but from big companies. Here, for instance, just two examples from Wales, a 76 turbine project in the Rhondda. Well, that's not funded by a British company or the Green Investment Bank, by Vattenfall from blooming Sweden. You know, why should the Swedes benefit from the wind power, wind energy in the Rhondda? Well, this is the norm in Britain today. You know, we have the same story, of course, with Hinkley Point. You know, the investment supposed to be coming from China and from France. Or here another, the second world's second largest offshore wind farm off the coast of North Wales. And who's funding it? It's Siemens, and that's also their turbines. It's E.ON from Germany, and the blooming city of Munich is paying for 30% of that development. Not Cardiff, not Liverpool, not Wrexham, but Munich. You know, it's just astonishing. So the money is coming from outside and the profits are going abroad again. And that, I think, is the norm of what is happening in Britain at this moment in time. And there we have to really begin to make a difference. And one of the people who is really making a difference in this context is also here on stage, Adam Twine, from this project, and he will talk about this in about 15 or 20 minutes. It's a very exciting and one of the truly pioneering community energy projects in this country. So really we need to get serious about an energy democracy. How can we talk about democracy in this country and, you know, wanting to claw it back from Brussels and from Europe if we are not prepared to do it in the energy context? So certainly, we need to think about shifting from being consumers of energy to prosumers, a kind of term that is beginning to make the rounds a little bit. And that is certainly beginning to be possible with new cost-competitive, non-fossil fuel technology options. So it's all about community ownership, participation, shared interest in renewable energy projects. It's about cooperatives, development trusts with tangible benefits to local people. This is the critical point now. And that certainly needs to be enabled, as I already said, by national policies such as feed-in tariffs. I was involved in 12 years ago to help introduce feed-in tariffs in Britain when we produced a book, colleagues of mine, simply on feed-in tariffs and their effectiveness in other parts of the world. And we managed to persuade Ed Miliband and then Gordon Brown to introduce these feed-in tariffs in Britain in 2009, it was. And so look at all the solar roofs we have in Britain. So that's not community renewables, that is private, of course, renewables. And that's great too. I mean, it's basically families and small households and sometimes housing trusts investing in renewables. But ultimately we need to think beyond that, because we need to also think about how to link that to the communities in which we live. And that's certainly, I think, one of the tasks we need to discuss and the issues we need to discuss here tonight. I mean, the figures from across Europe are really quite huge. 2,800 energy co-ops across Europe, and half of those actually in Germany, and a lot of them in Denmark, as I already said, quite a few in Holland, quite a few in France and Spain and so on. And also energy cooperatives are critically important for energy development in developing countries in Africa and in Asia and elsewhere. So, and that leads me to my last slide, which is the contrast to Petropolis is Ecopolis, the eco-city that relies much more than cities do today on renewable energy and hopefully in a cooperatively arranged process. So enough from me. I'm going to start introducing speakers, and our first speaker is Mr. Preben Magath, and he's just turning his back to us. Preben, I think you need to turn around. I'm talking about you now. Now, if there's a pioneer, there's quite a few pioneers in this room, but this man is truly a pioneer. And maybe I'm not correct in what I'm about to say, but I mean, when Denmark found itself without oil and gas and coal, unlike Britain and Norway in the 1970s, they thought, well, we'd better get real about wind energy and solar energy. And so Preben was one of the true pioneers in this. He's a true legend. And he has had many different functions as co-founder of the Nordic Folk Center for Renewable Energy. And he's also former chairman of the Danish Renewable Energy Association and vice president of Eurosolar and so many other things. But Preben, I have to say one thing. You've only got 15 minutes.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah? And there's a trap door under there.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
If you don't stop after 15 minutes.
Well, okay. I'll do my best. Thank you very much, Herbert, for the introduction. It's very interesting to be here today. And it's true that we in Denmark had a successful development of wind power, and it was from the beginning the community wind power that was taking the leadership. I have heard you also make some disappointing remarks here also, because today the community wind power, cooperative wind power, is not what it used to be, but we're working that this is a way to revitalize wind energy again at community level. So
let me see, do you just have to learn to use this one here?
It should be mentioned that renewable energy is now the leading technology also in terms of new power capacity. This is from an IRENA publication called Revitalizing Energy and Rethinking Energy is the name of it. And we see that since 2011, there has been installed year by year more renewable energy than coal and fossil fuel together. And that's a very promising development, of course, and now it should be around 60% every year. So this means we are on the way to the 100% renewable energy communities worldwide, even if it's going to take several years. But I take this up here on the rural development. This will be my main focus, but also to tell some to understand how the Danish energy system has developed. In 1975, we were nearly 100% depending on oil, and diversification was a main point, and it also was leading to decentralization of the energy system. We also made strong cable connections to other countries also. This was some of the main points of this development. But also the combined heat and power, which I mentioned earlier today, was extremely important for this development. But one point I think also should be mentioned is that the government early decided that conventional energy systems should no longer be allowed. So Denmark since 1980 has not been given permission to build conventional power stations. It's not been given, only combined heat and power since then. And this was this government that has to give the permissions, and it was not allowed. And the consequence of this is that we have a high share of combined heat and power, and this is with 60%, and we have also a high share of district heating, also over 60%. And last year, the wind energy covered 42% of all demand of electricity. That has also created new wind industries. 70,000 people are employed in the renewable energy sector, and of this, 28,000 in the wind industry alone. And you could multiply these figures with 12 to get a proportion between United Kingdom and Denmark. Just to understand also the size of energy sector in Denmark, that heating is a much bigger sector than electricity. Electricity is 35 terawatt hours, means billions of kilowatt hours, and transportation is 40, but heating is by far the most. So we have to consider this in any time we talk about future energy supply. Here's a very interesting picture. You see to the left here that Denmark is supplied in 1985 by few big power stations, and in 2014, so 30 years later, it's completely decentralization that has happened, partly due to the combined heat and power, but also to the many wind turbines. There would be around 5,000 wind turbines spread all over the country, seen on this picture there. And that has completely changed the Danish energy structure. And that will, in the coming years, change even more. Here we see how the wind energy has been growing. From 2007 alone, it was only 80%. Now, as mentioned, it was 42% last year. And it will be in 2020, 50%, and the aim is now, well, how much would it be? It may be that it is, also some figures that it will be maybe 2 to 3 times bigger than the demand for the electricity, as the classical electricity sector, so that also the the heating and transport sector for a great part will come from the wind power. But this also creating very big new challenges. You see here that on some occasions, this is on how which day was it? I have to look here more detail. It was in July 31st last year. The wind power on that day covered 190% of the demand of electricity. And that makes, of course, a special challenge to manage the system there. But there are also some other days. This is on a day in January that the wind power covered only 2%. That's what we have to live with. And that raises really big challenges in the future, how to manage them. But we are doing it, and it is possible to do. This is an important message from me today, that it will create completely new challenges and problems, but there are also ways to solve it. And it's not only hydrogen and so on, there are many solutions. I'm each year chairman of a small conference group in China called non-grid connected wind power, but it is connected, but it's not going into the grid, all of it. It's many different kinds of purposes also for this so-called excess power, which will be something we have to deal much more seriously with in the future. But when we talk about community power, we have a long tradition of this in Denmark. We have, especially in the district heating sector, it must by law, it must be community owned, only owned by consumers or the municipalities. But far most of them are owned by consumers. And as mentioned earlier, they deliver most of the heating in Denmark, and 98% in Copenhagen is coming from combined heat and power. And that means that we more than double the efficiency of our energy system by using the combined heat and power. And this is really also creating the, can we say, the background in the population also for other energy forms, not only the combined heat and power, but also solar energy, biogas energy, for wind energy partly also, but wind energy has been in some ups and downs over the last 2 decades or so. But the district heating is really a democratically owned energy sector. But we see here how the new solar district heating is coming. This means that you have big solar thermal installations, could be 100,000 square meters, and you can have big hot water storage ponds, which could be 200,000 cubic meters or more, and and supply town to 10,000 people, so on, over the season. And this is what is done at the local level, and by these local district heating companies, we are bought, elected by the consumers. And you see, here's one of them. It's in the municipality of Marstal and on Avon, an island installation here. And they get a big share of their heating coming from such solar heating. Well, I think this is the new we have to view in the future as a community power for the common good. Till now, in many countries, wind power has especially been for profit, been for investors. It's something we learned, especially in California back in the 80s, that that should be for profit. And also, most of the, we call the cooperatives in Denmark, was also people investing, individuals investing in it, and income from the wind turbines went into their private pockets. What I'm trying to show here is that we haven't found a way now to integrate this wind power, which is going to come much, much more. We have to integrate in our communities, and this uses as a basis for creating new income, but also to get the acceptance of the people. Acceptance is going to be the key word in the future. Because community power is owned and operated by the community, and that can be different kinds of technologies, but the financial benefits are returned to the community. And when I talk about community, it's not back to the individuals in the community, not money to their pockets, but money to the community so that they can take care of new initiatives and create new jobs and improve life conditions of living, because especially rural communities in Denmark have a very big difficulties with exodus, decreasing population, young people moving away, not coming back. We see many much degradation in the rural areas also, and it's not only a Danish phenomenon, it's something we see in several countries there. And here the wind power can come in and make some good, and I will come to a few examples. But how it was earlier done, so we see these many communities which were formed in the 1980s, and this was a norm when it started there. This was like such ones called Hornstrupmark, the wind turbine cooperatives. They had people signed such stuff, and then 50 families went together and invested in this as a common interest. But this was at that time also, where the local communities were much stronger than they are today. In the meantime, so many of the people that could take initiatives at the local level, they're gone, they're no more living there. And it's very many people that don't have the abilities, they cannot organize, they cannot overlook economies and so on. So we have to see it in different way now. So, well, this is how such a landscape in Denmark may look, and we have these cooperatives owning the wind turbines. But in 1992, something happened which made a change. From now on, the communities could no longer go and find the sites, they could no longer do the planning, because it was not fully controlled by society where the wind turbines were coming up, because it was where the people were taking initiatives. So now the planning, instead of being from below, it become top-down planning. This was first. In 1998, something new happened, is that from now on, everyone could be owners of the wind turbines. And I don't think this minister by that time, he was called Auken, he was very popular and also supporting decentralized development. But he said now everyone could invest in wind power, also people in the cities, because they were often complaining about that they could not participate in the projects, because up till then you had to be a resident in a municipality or the neighboring municipality. But that meant that it was people could identify with the wind turbines because they belonged to the community. But now everyone could belong to them, or could own them. And what was the consequence of that? It was not intentional, but after a 10 to 15 years period, there were hardly no more local ownership. And what was 165,000 families at a certain time that were owners of wind turbines there. Today, we don't have the figures exactly, but it is certainly reduced by a factor of 5 or 8 compared to what we had by that time. So it's very few now that are owners of wind of cooperatives. And of course, this is disappointing to some of you that this is no longer the norm in Denmark. But I can take in the municipality where I live, there were 4,000 families in 2002 that were owners of wind turbines. Today, they are owned by a handful, two handfuls of investors. So this is, of course, an enormous loss of democracy, of local democracy, that what was early in the hands of the people is no more. But this was so, it has gone well for 20 years. Then an investor comes and says, I will buy it, because there also came a repowering program saying, I will buy it, I will pay the same price like it cost when it was new. And they said, well, it has gone well for so long time, so I will, we better sell it before some happens to the wind turbine, if we have to invest new money, and this is too much of a risk. And this is what makes the change. So what about the future? So we have now, because of this change from community owned to investor owned, protest groups coming up. We can see at this moment could be around 200 protest groups, and this means that since this change of policy, that we had no residential requirement, that the number of people at the local level that owns are much less. And we know that people in general, 80% of the population are for wind power. It could be at least, yeah, big majority is for, but when you come out at the local level, the same 80% or so are against. And this is a dilemma we have to find a solution to. Here we have an diagram showing what could be the community power for the future. If you look here to the right side, you see what's called commercial wind power, and this is causing this opposition, this NIMBY effect, and that leads to cancellation of onshore wind projects. Then you go offshore, and offshore is more costly than onshore. Then the other way is community. This is what you see to the left side, is what is community ownership, where the purpose is for the common good. This makes local acceptance, and then onshore leads into the local development. And we made such a report at the Folkecenter saying this, that it leads to energy democracy, local acceptance, community development, and lower electricity prices. It's all desirable aspects. Sorry. Because we see here, in the middle here, the investor comes out in the community, says, well, I want to take over your land, but the people saying, well, you are not wanted here. We will protest against your product. Then the investors go offshore, and we see here, such like we have products that cost saying here 1.05 in Danish money, this is around 15 pence. And we have to the other side a democratic solution, which could be around, I have to calculate in 5 cents or so. This is a comparison we can talk about. And so it makes really a difference if we do the one or the other. The same picture here again also, that we have when it's seen only as investor solutions, but we see here to the right side is a total disaster. It is that some big investors like Vattenfall buy up big areas of land, take down the houses, close villages, and people move away so they can make big wind farms there. And again, we have here to the left the community solutions. And this is important because with local ownership, we get acceptance, we get local initiative, we get improved economy, and we can make a new development. And so these projects must have the acceptance of your residents. And then, of course, also like Herbert was doing, is any democracy possible? I cannot see any other way than to have it. And we have made some plan to make an accept bonus. And this means it's about let's say 1.5 cents, no, 1.5 pence or so, is going to the community, and in whole that makes the electricity much cheaper than before. And the fine example we have of that, that is in a small town, fishing town, called Hvidesande. But earlier they had presented an investor project, and the people protested against it. About 2,000 people signed that they did not want to have it. And then 2 years later was presented the project was income from the wind turbines were going to be invested in improvement of the harbor. It could be also other improvement of infrastructure, investment in the schools, in public buildings, and so. And now the people that had protested against these wind turbines earlier, no protest whatsoever, no protest. And this is what is now going to be one of our solutions for the future. And you see them here, that it has really revitalized this fishing town. And it's only 2 weeks ago, I went to a meeting. See, it's very modest, what we see here. People sitting in a local community. And I see this is what we will have the new support from below. This is in a school in a small town. It suffers from a problem. We're sitting in the school here that it is. They have less and less children for the school. They're going to close the school maybe, and then the people now go together and see the wind turbines, which we will invest in here in this community, should be owned by a local foundation. And this foundation should go into social housing, and with social housing, then we can get young people to take over the empty houses. And with the young people in the empty houses, there will be children to the school, and then we will keep our school. This is a good story. And I think this is the new development we will have in the future, not money in the pockets, but the money for the community. And there are many good purposes, and I have a brochure I can show you. And but heaven is just behind me here, yes. So this is going to be for another time. Thank you.
And convention on the Oxfordshire borders. He initiated and was founder, director of Westmill Wind Cooperative and Westmill Solar Cooperative. He set up and directed the farm carbon cutting toolkit as well, and he was also a recipient of a Schumacher Award in 2007 and also a recipient of the 2015 Community Energy Champion Award. So over to you, Adam, to talk and tell us about your exciting story.
Thanks, Herbie. Thank you, and very inspiring to hear your story, Prima. I feel like we're such a long way behind in England, and so interesting to see how that shifts from being sort of bottom up to top down, and then hopefully bottom up again. You're going to get a very different.
It's possibly too bright now. Is there a sort of intermediate way of lighting this room?
Dimmers.
Sorry about this.
Okay. You're going to get a different version from me. You're just going to hear about one project or a couple of projects which I've been involved in. Herbie asked me to start from where it began. So I'm a farmer, and that means I have access to land, which is very useful if you're doing any projects which involve the land. And I also have a business. So I was looking to how to use my farm in a wider sense, how the land could be used in other ways. And having been an anti-nuclear campaigner back in the 80s and a reader of Undercurrents, I had an interest and a passion for low energy and soft energy paths, and the idea of wind power felt like that was a possibility. I think there weren't any wind farms in the UK at that stage, but it felt like that was a possibility. I started that. This slide here is when we launched our share offer for the solar farm. You can see the wind turbines in the back and the solar farm, and that was that. So, and I guess it was the inspiration of Denmark which made me think about community ownership, because we hadn't got any in the UK back when I started in the early 90s. And So thanks to what Denmark was doing, I never believed that we could have a community-owned scheme because there weren't any in the UK, and you know, why were we going to be so lucky? I wanted to be, but didn't believe it would. And I guess it was thanks to Denmark and thanks to Undercurrents again, which put those ideas through. So that sense of informing us was important. This is the wind farm. I'm not sure if you can quite see the turbines there. It's in the Vale of the White Horse, on the Oxfordshire-Wiltshire border. There are 5 wind turbines. And I guess there we have the launch of WOW, which is the community group which campaigned for it. That says 2003. The project actually started in nearly 10 years before that, which was largely driven by myself. It was more of a one-person initiative rather than a community initiative for quite a long time. And then as the opposition started coming towards me, I realised I wanted to be a community project, but I was sort of driving it as mainly the planning at that stage and getting the data for the wind speeds to see if we had a viable project or not. As the opposition started picking up, we had a meeting of family and friends around the kitchen table, and we thought we ought to launch a campaign group. So this was the launch of WOW. There will be some Undercurrents readers in there somewhere. And it was in response to WOW's wind power of West Mill, in response to VEX, Vale environmental concerns. And I guess the thing about what was being said about bottom up, it is a soft power. When you see, when I think about community ownership projects, renewable energy rather than just renewable energy, the wind turbines, the solar panels, the biomass boilers, they're the hard stuff, and the people are the soft stuff. We don't see that as being so powerful, but when you're trying to bring projects forward, it certainly is, definitely is powerful. Oops, next one, sorry. Okay. And then this is the hard stuff. So this is the 5 wind turbines, 6.5 megawatts installed, and 5 megawatts installed solar panels. That was a few years ago. We got the planning for the wind turbines took ages. So when I showed you that launch of WOW nearly 9 years on, I'd been working on planning for that time, and we'd had 2 planning permissions but was unable to take them to fruition to build them out for a variety of reasons which I'd happily chat about in the discussion. And we were going for the 3rd planning permission at that point. So it is, I guess, one of the lessons which I take for this is that it's very long process. Long-term process. One of the challenges, I think, for community ownership is it is much longer than when you're doing things commercial. So the title of the presentation was Community Energy to the Rescue, and I guess in terms of climate change, it's one of our challenges as practitioners is it tends to be slower, but of course it's engaging the hearts and minds, and that's the other bit of community energy which commercial developments doesn't do. Sorry, done that again. Go back again. Okay, and so that's almost like the end, not quite the end of the story, but that was taken in 2013, so 10 years later. That's when we had, that was at the Solar Co-op's AGM, first AGM, and that's with the wind turbines and solar panels in the background there. You won't see him, but there's Peter Harper right in the middle there. And this is along the way. So this is part of the campaigning. This was us digging the foundations for the first wind turbines. We hadn't raised any money. We hadn't done anything, but it was part of our campaigning strategy. Let's keep going with that one. And the campaigning strategy, I'd happily chat about more in the discussion if that seemed appropriate. Raising the money, is clearly one of the biggest hurdles after the planning you come across, and we did a share offer for the wind farm and a share offer for the solar farm. When we did the wind farm share offer, a co-op had never done a share offer for, we were looking for £5.5 million, and so we had no idea whether we would pull it off or not. And I guess that's also an aspect of community development. I think it's an act of faith. I suspect in Denmark, those early pioneers were doing something because they believed in it, and they believed they could make it work. Slightly, with the hindsight now, it feels almost naive to me, because I realised there was, as I look back, because although the wind turbines there look very solid, it could have gone either way so many times. It is partly about luck, I think, and partly about faith. I think that believing what you're doing does make a difference. This is the construction, just pictures of the construction, wind farm, and the one at night was taken as the last blades was being, the last cell was being lifted. It was extraordinary to me how quickly that happened. And the cranes, there were two cranes involved in the hoisting of the blades, and it's like a dance. It was very, very beautiful to watch. And then, I guess, what makes community energy different from commercial projects? Clearly the people. This is us trying to set a Guinness Book of World Records or the record number of people hugging a wind turbine. And I guess the people feels, it's not obvious, but it feels the most important thing, because if we're serious about climate change, it is about making the changes inside each of us, in all of Bristol, in all of the South West, in all of UK and Denmark and so on. It is that sense of reaching out to engage people and to want to make the change. So the point that was being made about bottom-up and less nimbyism, if we're serious and we're going to have a lot more wind turbines in the UK, which if we think we're going to be producing low-carbon electricity, we're going to need, we have to buy into it. People have to buy into it. So it is that sense of how to engage people, and community ownership is clearly very much part of that. But part of the campaigning is that as well. When we were in the long years of trying to get planning, all the public meetings felt like an opportunity to be talking about climate change. That was what it was really about. It wasn't about, I mean, the amount of kilowatts we generate, I think, is probably much less significant than the message which the turbines send out, and the fact that it's community-owned, people have bought into it, they're doing more than changing the light bulbs. We all want to be doing more than changing the light bulbs. Education, so we set up a charity which called WESET, West Midlands Sustainable Energy Trust. It does a range of things. It gets, I think it's 25 grand from the wind and solar farm now. In the early days it was only getting 5 grand before the solar farm came on board, and it was run by love, as all these things are, and it's done a lot of outreach. So it's engaged with schools in all sorts of ways. The turbines are all named by local schools. There've been competitions. We have schools visits all through the year. We have a host of volunteers who take school visits around, and we have open days for councillors, for other localities which are thinking about a wind farm. Here, you come and listen to ours, see how noisy it really is. And for groups like CPRE, who are campaign for the protection of rural England, who are naturally nervous about wind turbines because they do affect the landscape. This is part of what community ownership does as well. We also have insulated our local village hall, and we have solar panels on the sports pavilion and about to go up on the village hall. A whole range of things which have been funded by the local project, so we are very much meshed in there. It's an ape talk, this is a sculpture. We have arts was part of WESET's remit, and so this is a sound acoustic sculpture, and when the wind blows you hear a chorus or a cacophony, depending on your take on it, of sound. Now we've had photo competitions and filmmaking and stuff like that. And this is a bit of art which was uninvited when the first wind turbines were put up. We had a crop circle in the field next door, which was rather fine. I put it in because the design reminded me a bit of the sort of radical technology design logo. So looking forwards and lessons learned, it always takes a lot longer than you think it's going to take. It's a complete roller coaster. At times it looked like it would never happen. We had raised the money, we'd raised we'd raised 5.5 million quid, we got a loan from the Co-op Bank. We went to place our order and we couldn't get the order. The orders were all taken because they were all going to the States. So we went back and we had to rethink and stuff like that. We had an AGM and we had the AGM coming up, and just prior to the AGM, the bonus, who had then been taken over by Siemens, who were the turbines we were hoping to install, for some reason which I have no idea why, came back and said, if you can put your order in within 6 weeks, we can have 5 turbines to you by the end of the year. But we'd already returned the million quid to members because we went going for that project. We were exploring another project. And so our AGM was coming up, and we had to ask the question to members, a year after we'd originally raised the money, can we raise £1 million again to put this order in, within 4 weeks, as it was then, to put this order in? Will you back us to do that? We'd been sitting on the money for a year. It was a very unknown project. We were a group of largely amateurs. Well, none of us had experience in the wind industry, which is another challenge for community groups. We all had different experiences in finance or engineering and stuff like that, but none of us were wind experts. And we had the AGM, and the first questions were all quite negative, saying, actually, we don't think you're doing this very well. We think we want our money back, or we think we need to rethink this very carefully. And then there's a guy at the back who stood up and said, actually, this project is a groundbreaking project. We can't let it fail. We have to go out and get that money. And that changed the audience, the tone changed, and we raised £1 million quid within a month. From, we couldn't advertise, we had to go back to our members because we went and had to do another share offer. We had to go back, and I didn't want to put any more money in. I thought, I'm not sure we're going to do it. I didn't believe it would happen, but we did. And it is that complete roller coaster. Community projects are like that. That was one of the lessons I was going to say. I guess keeping the money in the local community is very important. Not having to relearn the lessons is important. You know, we all learned so much on that journey. There are great resources now for community energy projects out there. Community Energy England has the Community Energy Hub. Lots of resources, lots of expertise, which is exciting going forwards. And I suspect I'm probably nearly to finishing, and I'd happily answer questions about Westmill. I don't want to, you know, I could talk for ages about the share offer, about the planning struggles, about the makeup of the board, about how we got, you know, set the finances up and so on. But rather than get caught up with that, one of the things which I take away, and I guess as part of the Radical Technology Conference, is something, and being an Undercurrents reader, you know, many years ago, it's something about those waves. You know, we're a very small project. We provide enough electricity for our local market town, which is about 9,000 people, for the wind farm, and about another 3,500 people on the solar farm for their domestic energy requirements. We're very small. We're right next to Didcot Power Station, within sight of it. We're about 1% of Didcot as our output. But it's something about how things change, and how we can't necessarily see the results of our actions. And I was inspired by what's happening in Denmark. And I suppose I'd like to think Westmill would go on and inspire other projects. And to make the change happen that we all want, it is that aggregation of projects where we can't see where they're going to end. Doing what we believe in is what's really important, because that sort of energy, I think, goes out beyond. So, and for all of you community energy practitioners out there, keep up the good work. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Adam, for telling us this very exciting story. We need lots of projects like this, and there are quite a few more of these projects that you help to initiate, because by setting that example, I think others started to follow. I've got friends who have set up similar wind schemes in Gloucestershire, and so unfortunately Andrew Clark, who would have talked about that, he's in Oxford for the conference there. But anyway, so there's certainly projects of this kind beginning to pop up in various parts of the UK. But now we're going to have a very different journey, a story about a very different journey from Wendy Stevenson, She's based in Bristol, so we're coming back to Bristol itself. But Wendy and John Ponto, who's also in the room here, have a project in India called The Converging World, and Wendy will explain to us how that features as a community project, as well as the project to try and generate funds, ultimately also for future generations. So Wendy is the CEO of The Converging World. She is a renewable energy engineer with 15 years of experience in the environment and climate change sector. She worked overseas for many years in the oil and gas industry before returning to UK as head of environmental affairs for EEF, based in Westminster. She's also worked with community groups, and she will explain to us what The Converging World is doing both in Bristol and in India.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sorry it's a PDF, but I don't trust the formatting. So, okay. So, The Converging World really started back in about 2005 with John Pontin and Ian Roderick, who came up with the idea of their village wanted to go zero waste on everything. And it was called Go Zero, and it started with John Pontin reenacting the role of William Shipley years ago for the RSA, who said that there must be more to business than making money. And what they did was that they were sending kids up chimneys and they were dying, and they said they had the competition, there was something to do with reforestation. Anyway, John was reenacting that role, and they came in their village. Lots of people said, well, they had somebody along from Climate Care to talk about CO2 emissions reduction, and they said, well, the cheapest way to do that is to actually do it overseas, because it's a lot cheaper to reduce a ton of CO2 there. And some people in the village said, well, why would we do that? That just doesn't make sense. And then other people said, well, why should we bother when India and China are economically developing at the rate that they are? We won't make really much of a difference at all. And at that, a few people got together and said, well, actually, we should really be trying to find a community in India or China that we can twin with on sustainable development and tackling climate change together. Soon after that, serendipity took them to India. They met somebody from India, he came over, and John went out to India to meet them to see what they were doing. At the time, they weren't working in sustainable development, they were working in village empowerment, women's empowerment, but John went out there. And actually what happened was, when he was out there, he saw that it was a really windy place. So he had the idea that, why don't we invest in wind farms here, renewable energy, we will sell the power and we will use the surplus for social and environmental development, both in that area and some of the money would flow back to the UK where the investment originally came from. So that was the big idea. And the first wind turbines, if you like, went in back in 2008. So the first ones went in with donations, largely from John and Indian Bank Finance. And then in 2012, we did some crowdsource funding. And we said, lend us a fiver, we'll pay you 6% over 5 years, and your money back at the end of that. And we managed to raise enough to put in another 1.5 megawatts in India. And then we thought we grew up a little bit, and you might know about EIS, which is a bit more sophisticated in that you can only go to a certain number of people and you fall under FSA regulations. And we got clearance to do that, and we raised enough money, again with bank finance in India, to put in another 8.4 megawatts. So that was 3 years ago now. We're into our fourth windy season back in... it went in 2013, so it's 3 years old now. Altogether, they're capable of producing about 25 million kilowatt hours. And I think the interesting thing is that for every kilowatt hour we produce there, we save twice as much CO2 as we would if that kilowatt hour was generated here in the UK. So the CO2 avoidance is twice as effective. To date, we've generated about 70 million kilowatt hours. We had a slight delay on our wind farm, so this is the first year that we're really generating properly with the new one. But since we've installed those wind farms, We've generated about 70 million kilowatt hours, and we've reduced or avoided, I don't like to use the word reduced because it's not actually reducing CO2, we've avoided 60,000 tonnes of CO2. So although they're not massive figures, and especially in a place like India where you've still got 350 million people still without access to electricity, they're not insignificant for the small amount of time that we've had to actually get going on this. And then we've had funds that have been available to go into various community projects, including cook stoves, solar, working with the local villagers in the beginning around some of those, and also grants for social initiatives, so health. You know, they're very poor people, and access to water. Now you might say, well, what's this got to do with community energy? Because actually it does look like we've gone in and done this, which is quite true. And I'll come on to that. Of course, the social returns on investments, we're becoming much more aware of those. And this is just an example of some of the social returns we get just from the renewable energy that we put in. And when you then add in, so we have a fund that would actually generate, that would have an income. That in itself has a return. But when you look at the avoidance of water, water's a big issue in India. And when you've got coal-fired power stations and other technologies that require water, that's a really big issue. And even if you just do a pound for a cubic metre, then the returns just on the avoidance of using that water are massive in terms of the social impact returns. And also just in terms of the avoided CO2 and the UN guidelines on the cost to reduce a tonne of CO2. So, you know, you get massive returns when you take into account the sort of social impact as well. You know, 45% return on for every pound. So it's quite significant. So what do our charitable programmes look like? The one that I'm going to talk about two tonight. This is where we tend to feature. So we've got ecological restoration, we feel is really important. I'm going to talk a little bit about that. But the access to affordable, sustainable energy is where we now go into the work that we're doing around community energy in India. And I'm really fascinated by Denmark and what they've done, because I think that there could be some real sharing of the journey that they've gone through with India, because India is so far behind in terms of that I think that there's some real examples that we could bring to play. So one of the big programs that we've been invited to develop with a few states in India is the low carbon development programs. They approached us last year, and they came with a document that was just about energy infrastructure. And of course, low carbon development is much more than just energy infrastructure. It's much more. However, we looked at that, and we've partnered with an organization in India, and we're doing some really exciting and innovative work around there. So some of the things that we're looking at are solar villages, and I'll go into that a little bit more in a moment. We're also looking at district-wide community-owned energy, because it's not really been done in India at the moment. And it's quite exciting that the MPs are getting quite excited about that possibility. They've had their fingers burnt. There's been some, I'm not going to name the companies, but there's been some large companies from America and even the UK that have gone into India, and their whole business model is to buy energy assets and then sell them high. So their business model is to make money on buying the assets and then selling them, rather than actually buying them, developing them, installing them, and make sure they're operating well for the benefit of the whole sector. And it's left terrible problems in the Indian market because of the idea that, well, let's just buy these assets and make money on them, because that's their business model. And so we've been talking with the MPs, we've been discussing this with the MPs, and we said, well, there is a better model where the district-wide energy can be effectively community-owned, or at least you can ring-fence it so it can go back into the community. And so we're going to try this bottom-up approach, and we're just now starting with a few pilots. There's 9 other MPs interested to sign up to this, so it's quite exciting, and it could be quite a change, a game changer for India if we can get this, if we can get the politicians really interested, and we can get the momentum behind it. Just talking about the sort of investments, if you go for the large-scale wind projects in India, some of the challenges that we face is the high cost of finance. You know, you might be able to borrow from banks here at less than 10%, or 6%, or 8%, but in India it's 13%. But the projects are good. You know, after paying sort of operations and maintenance and staff, you know, 80%. Of your income is still available, but at 13% and very short-term loans, because infrastructure funding is not as well, is not as sophisticated as it has been in Europe, then it squeezes you, so a lot of your surplus just goes to the banks. So one of our big strategic shifts at the moment is that we're going to look to actually take out the banks, because otherwise we're just working for the banks at the moment. So we're going to look for impact investment over a longer period of time that allows some of that surplus to go into the community energy projects that we're wanting to develop. The infrastructure in India needs much more investment, so you have to be careful where you actually invest in your wind farms. You know, I know that ours is creaking, but theirs hasn't really developed to the as fast as them putting in wind farms and solar farms, so you have to be really careful around that. And of course, you still have 350 million people that don't have access to electricity, and a large proportion of them don't have access to the grid even. Enforcing incentivized frameworks. So here you get ROCs, you get your renewable obligation certificate, that whole thing. And I know it's changing and there's never much certainty around some of these. But in India, one of the problems you have is that you might have a regulatory incentive that's it's in regulation, but the enforcement doesn't happen. So we are very careful about not putting that in any of our projections. And we don't. And it's still working without those. If those actually get enforced and they come on stream, then we'll be doing far, far better than we'd anticipated. And believe it or not, even though you've got a national grid, we can't sell from one state to another yet. It's coming in the next 2 or 3 years, which will help the whole market, but it's very frustrating when they could be exporting wind or solar across various states. And navigating the bureaucracy is that's one of the legacies we left, but it's far worse, and it's a challenge. And I had brown hair when we started, and So the big exciting thing that really, I mean, this is what really brings joy. I mean, it's fantastic putting renewable energy in, if we can do it district wide and it's community owned, or at least owned by a charity that can actually distribute that surplus money back to community benefit. But this really is exciting. If we can work on the low carbon development plans at a community level, so we get solar villages. At the moment, there are examples of off-grid, effectively, solar villages. So they own their solar and they just have it within their village. But it doesn't get exported back in with income coming back. So they're not getting paid for it. And we've just managed to get approval for it. So the organisation we're working with, you may know of Oroville, we're working with Oroville Consultancy, who share the same value system as we do. So it's excellent that we're working together. And they've just got a feed-in tariff in Pondicherry, which is fabulous, because for a long time, people were feeding back into the grid and not getting anything for it. There was no incentive. And are now working on ensuring that there will be the transformer and the regulations around that will allow a two-way feed, so we can actually feed back in. And once you get that, that will transform the incentives and India from the bottom up. And I really would like to connect with the Denmark story and actually just, talk around that and at least open that up for discussion with India. So the challenges that we've got to overcome to do that are changing the regulations, and that's something that we're working with, and actually Oroville Consultancy have a very good relationship in terms of policy development. And community ownership, traditionally sweat equity, because how do you get community that is very poor to have anything other than a sweat equity, in effect finding the funds to be able to own some of that, and we're having to work on how that might come about. And the other thing I think which is really important is the green bling. You know, it's one thing to go into a village, and I've been to some extremely poor villages that have hardly any electricity. And who am I to say that they shouldn't develop? And it's not about that. But it's also not about just putting in a few solar panels and then walking away and thinking that you solved a problem. Because often when you go to these villages, people are very happy. And their well-being is often, you know, we can't do this. Just park a load of green bling and walk away and say that that's the job done. We have to have a holistic approach to this. And I think that's where there's an opportunity with the low carbon development plans to actually look at the whole thing and not just a bit of green bling, that's that box ticked, because there are unintended consequences that come about because of that. I just want to move on to this. So this is one of the ecological programs. It's important in the context of low carbon development and working in India as a whole, and it being not just about green bling. So one of the states that we're working in is the state of Odisha. And one evening I was having dinner with the MP, and he said, you know, Wendy, I think it's great. The Converging World model of community ownership around renewable energy is fabulous. He said, but my biggest headache is that I have 300,000 distressed migrants from my district, because they only grow rice for part of the year, and then they have to go off and find work. And often they will go off to the brick kilns with the children, and they won't have any money, so they borrow from the people that own the brick kilns, and then they get locked into it, and they can't get away, and they can't get back. So this is a real problem. So when you're working in a place like India, you know, the priority isn't necessarily putting solar panels in a village. The priority is how you look at the whole thing holistically. And we have been working with some people who've been doing some reforestation in a part of India near Auroville. And the thing that reforestation does is it supports local communities. So it helps with water retention, because water is a big issue. It provides food and it provides products, so Ayurvedic medicines. It provides a living for many of the local people. And you know, there's also, you can do reforestation with some agroforestry, and you can put in organic produce in and around this. And it reduces CO2. Renewable energy avoids CO2. So if we can pay the banks off, if we can find long-term impact investment from the renewable energy that we have, then we would like to use some of those funds to also put into reforestation. Because you end up with, this is in 1969, one of the projects that our partner has been involved with right at the very beginning. And there used to be 1,000 kilometres of tropical dry evergreen forest down the eastern seaboard. Today there's 4 hectares of full canopy forest left. It used to support elephants and tigers and, of course, people. It managed the microclimate, the water, the food, everything. And what happens is you end up with something that looks like the moon, and people are eking out a living. And then what they do is they migrate to the cities, and the cities cannot support them. So these people started working on this, collecting seeds from the sacred groves, which were the indigenous species. And they had to sometimes carry water for 5 kilometres to make sure that these seedlings actually survived. And today, it looks like this. And that was just a handful of people. And that is alive. So I don't want to sound controversial, but there's nothing really radical about planting a tree. And it works. It's the most cost-effective way to reduce CO2. And it's the most cost-effective way to actually look after communities into the future. So, thank you.
Thank you, Wendy, and thank you, John Ponting. John is here, and he will also be happy to talk to any of you later on, because this is a very exciting story that has its origins in Bristol, and long may it live and long may it prosper. So we are now moving on to our next speaker, who is Peter Head. Now, he's the man with lots of letters behind his name, but I'll just say O-B-E. So Peter is a really eminent engineer. For those of you who live in Wales, you will have crossed his bridge many times, the second Severn Bridge, which he built some years ago. but he's also been head of sustainability at Arab, the civil engineering company, global civil engineering company, and he's a true champion of sustainable development. And as one of his most recent initiatives, he started the Ecological Sequestration Trust some 5 years ago, and he advocates that changing the way we invest public and private money in the built environment is key to creating a sustainable future, and in that context, of course, community energy is critical. So, Peter, over to you.
Thanks. Good evening, everybody. I'm not going to show any pictures. I'm just going to talk. And I decided I'd talk to try and follow up what others have just said. And you've made it very easy for me, actually. So I want you to think about a community, whatever size you think is appropriate, where you live. Imagine a community and imagine, okay, if you define it, you've got to draw a boundary around it. You've got to sort of draw a line on a map and you've got to work out where to draw that line. So the community could be quite small or it could be quite big. Everyone in the world could do that. And everyone in the world has basic needs. You have water supply, potable water supply needs. You need food. You need electricity. You need heat and cooling sometimes. And you need to deal with waste so you don't pollute your place, so it stays clean and nice to live in. Not really very demanding things. Now, everyone all over the world is thinking, how do I do that to deliver sustainable development goals, to deal with climate change, to deal with resource overstress, all the things that we now know are happening to us in different ways all over the world. And one of the things I'm doing right now is developing a platform so that every community in the world can model that. You can model the amount of rain that falls, the amount of sun that arises, what happens to the ecological systems and the human systems, and how can we organize all of that so it's more sustainable. So imagine for a minute that every community in the world has a tool where they can look at that as a system. So that's what we're working towards. Within about 4 years' time, we'll be able to roll out such a thing to everyone in the world. And I want 10,000 communities all over the world to have that by 2022. So let's go around the world now and look at what's actually happening on the ground. Basically, everyone has a broken system in that respect. Everyone. So we're currently working in Accra in Ghana, which is a terribly broken city, if any of you have been there. There's about 4 million people living in the greater area. About 80% of human waste, excrement, goes into the environment in what is a relatively modern city. And it floods, and so the excrement goes everywhere into the slums. There's cholera, there's terrible malaria, and this is a relatively modern city in some ways in Africa. And they're ashamed of it, but they don't know what to do about it. There's 16 districts, neighborhoods in Accra. They're all governed separately. They all don't communicate with each other. They've no idea how to share things. We've given them a systems model for the water and sanitation systems, and they've discovered very, very clearly that what they should be doing is installing decentralized biogas systems, which can be invested in by the private sector. Because actually, private sector investors, they can sell the gas for cooking, they can sell the compost for farmers. And that's enough money to pay for decentralized biogas systems that will clean up the whole city. And the private sector will do it. The government doesn't have to do anything. Well, they didn't know that. They've had Chinese trying to build centralized sewage works with pipes that aren't connected properly, that flood and don't work. And they're trying to learn from the craziness of the Western world, you know, of Basil Jess in London and everybody who thought that was the right solution, because we didn't have the type of technologies we now have to do things at a decentralized, smaller scale. So basically, I think we probably all agree that actually technology is moving us to the point where we can do everything at a very small, relatively neighborhood scale and solve all of those problems as a system. So just don't don't think about electricity. Think about electricity, think about heat, think about food, think about water, and think about waste management. And then you suddenly get paradigm shifting opportunities where all these things fit together. And with the technologies we have, it can be made to happen. I'm going to give you an example in a minute of something that's really transformational that we can actually do here. One of the things that we've discovered, I've just done something called Roadmap 2030, which crazily is a roadmap for investing in this transformation for the whole world by 2030. And the amount of money required to do this is about 5% of GDP invested every year in every community in the world to deal with public transport, energy, water, waste systems. So if you imagine your little community in Bristol and you take 5% of the GDP, you know, the amount of money that flows through your community, that's the sort of money you should be thinking you should invest in sorting all this out for yourselves, 5% a year. And if you think about the amount of money you currently spend on energy and water and waste and everything else, it's a hell of a lot more than that sum of money. So actually, if you start taking control of that system for yourselves, it's very likely you're going to find a paradigm-shifting solution, which is exactly what everyone's just been telling you. And that includes the forests, the wetlands, the farmland, the farm waste, and everything else that comes out of it. So that 5% is available. There is enough money, capital in the world to do this. So the problem isn't the amount of capital, as you've just illustrated, with pension funds and private capital. There's enough money in the world to get us to 2030 in a sustainable way for about 5 billion people living in cities. We just don't have the means of connecting the money to local community and neighborhood decision making, which is what I'm hoping to do. 20% of the money will come from the public sector and 80% will come from the private sector, which is you and me and the way we choose to spend our money. So that's why the sort of solutions that you're developing with India are so powerful, because that's 80% of the problem you're working with to solve. So it's a very optimistic picture if we can take this understanding of the way new technology can make it work. So I've given you an example of Accra in Ghana. Let me give me a little example of a hilltop village I visited in China. We're working in Sichuan to help them with the disaster risk reduction due to earthquakes, mudslides, and all the things that are terrible things that are happening in Chinese mountains with earthquakes. And we went to the Yi village in China, and we found people there had solar hot water systems on their roofs, and they had biodigesters next to their toilet blocks. So they were having hot showers, and they were proudly turning on the taps to show they're cooking with their own biogas. And it was so inspiring for me just to see this simple technology in a local village community. They are connected to the grid in China. They've made that decision. But everything else was operating locally, and they were so proud and excited of it. You know, they felt they had modern technology, but it was operating in a very simple and really cheap way with very simple maintenance. So let's come back to the UK. We need 1 million affordable homes in the UK, and we need to build them really quickly, and we need to build them on public land, and we need to get people into affordable homes. I've been helping and inspiring along a way of thinking about buildings, which is to turn them into power stations. Because all our buildings, they receive sunlight all through the year, low sun in the winter, which heats the walls up, direct sunlight in the summer, which provides a lot of opportunity for PV. And I've always been convinced that if we could harness all of that, all of those systems, we could probably turn buildings into power stations. So actually, over a year, if you could store the energy, both the heat and the electricity, you could probably get away with a net zero energy system, which means there's no net purchasing of either heat or electricity through the year. Now, with a government that believes we should start fracking, and why do we need gas? The only reason we need gas is to heat our homes, to actually create electrical power in power stations and some industrial use. So instead of bribing everyone by giving them money to do fracking, why don't we actually think about buildings as power stations that actually don't need any gas through the year and actually generate enough electricity. Well, this is going to be possible because Swansea and Cardiff University have been working, and I'm on the advisory board, of developing all the technologies we need to integrate them together into affordable homes, to create homes that need no net energy during the year. And they do it by having a battery that stores electrical power, and they do it by having hot water that stores heat that can be gathered from the walls of the building in the summer, and in the winter you can't get enough heat that way, so you have to use a bit of the electricity from the grid to actually heat the water. And it's warm air heating, so you don't have radiators and hot water stuff. It's warm air heating. Now, they've got a demonstration building, which you may have read about, called the Solskjaer House, which is operating in Cardiff on a fairly windy sort of place. And that's looking really promising. I'm not that confident we've got it sorted yet. But the really significant thing about this is if you take this technology and apply it to 1 million homes, affordable homes, and these are affordable homes, and people can live in them without actually having any net payment for electricity or heat for the whole year. You imagine what that's like as someone who needs an affordable home. That is going to be possible. If we build 1 million of them, each of them having a 6 kilowatt battery, which is about what these buildings need, you've got enough power to be delivered to the grid in the peak in December when you need another power station to remove at least 2 nuclear power stations from the UK. So instead of building 2 nuclear power stations, we can build 1 million affordable homes that don't require any heat and electricity. And the grid will be supplied with energy in the winter when we need it from the batteries in all the homes. And the technology exists to do this. You know, the grid is set up to do this. There are people trading energy in the grid that can actually make this happen. So we don't need to build Hinkley nuclear power station. And possibly, as we go forward, we don't need to build another one. So basically every country in the world which is facing either renewing a grid infrastructure, renewing power stations, or hasn't got them at all and needs to build something new, can move towards a decentralized neighborhood energy system which is heat and electricity and can deal with water management, waste management and everything else at the same time. So it's actually a very exciting story, and you're seeing little pinprints of ideas here, but actually they can be expanded to a much, much deeper and more significant transformation. With around 5% of GDP invested per year, the capital's available. So the final bit of the story is that what we're trying to do in the UK now, we're going to try and do it in Monmouthshire, we're going to try and do it in Stirling in Scotland, and maybe even in a borough of London, is to create a regional development fund that can be drawn down into community projects to enable us to demonstrate this process and the transformation to happen. And all of the investment banks and others and social impact investors and people like John, who's nodding down there, are very interested in investing in these things. So we can set up these funds so communities can then really undertake a more holistic approach and draw in all of these other technologies which are available. So it is actually a very exciting and transformational moment, and the fact that every government in the world has signed up to the Sustainable Development Goals and has signed up to not ambitious enough goals to reduce carbon emissions, I think it's likely we can show that we can actually reduce the emissions much more than we ever imagined was possible if we use a systems approach. Thanks.
The exciting thing is that Peter just doesn't just talk about these things, he actually does them, and this is what we need to get out of this meeting. You know, years ago when Undercurrents first came out and Resurgence, we had the Schumacher Society in Bristol, we were talking about stuff. The time has come for doing, and this is really what is so critical, both in terms of the climate change picture, in terms of poverty around the world. You know, these new technologies and new investment models are available to be implemented. And now we would like to go back to Bristol and talk, have Andy O'Brien talk about what he has been doing here in this very city. He's the founder director of the Bristol Energy Cooperative. He has 15 years of experience in the IT and project management, including work for Triodos Bank and Bristol City Council. And he's built considerable expertise in the financial, regulatory and legal aspects of the renewable and community energy sector. So over to you, Andy O'Brien.
Yeah, so thanks very much for having me along. My background is actually originally was in teaching, and then I moved into IT. So I didn't have a lot to do with energy for many years, and I just lived as a citizen and just sort of took energy for granted, really. But I had been involved for quite a few years with sort of third world development issues, and some of the organisations I'd been involved with started talking about climate change, so I thought maybe I should get a bit more involved with this. So that's how I got into this, really, and eventually I thought I'll take it a bit more seriously, so I dropped my working day to a 4-day week, and on that fifth day I helped set up a local sustainability group where I was living in Bristol. And then through that, got to know other people doing similar things, and together we got together and formed the co-op. So that was us back in 2011, we set up Bristol Energy Co-op. And yeah, our idea was to actually sort of get on and do stuff, even if it wasn't big stuff. We just felt we needed to actually translate our frustration and our desire to do things into real action. And the nice thing was that other groups were doing things around us. I was really lucky because we got Adam there. You know, we could look at the Westmill model and what they'd done and how they'd done it. I was also fortunate enough to invest a little bit in the Converging World turbines, so I knew a little bit about that. So I had those bits in the back of my mind, but it was a question of how we moved that all forward. And also to say, we start off with renewables, but also ideally we would start off with energy efficiency, because that would be sort of saving the most carbon. But so far we haven't been able to find the financial model for doing that. So we started off with something which is recognisable to the public and was a way of getting going, and that was solar. And the nice thing is that it's not just us doing it, there are lots and lots of groups doing this around the country. I'm going to that Community Energy Conference tomorrow in Oxford, and there will be hundreds probably of groups actually represented there now, because there's so much going on. Anyway, so back in 2012, we did our first share offer, and that was to put solar panels on the roofs of three community buildings in Bristol. And we got 160 investors, raised £125,000, and those installations are still running now. So our investors are getting a return on their investment, the building users get subsidised green energy, and it's all been going well for the last few years. 2014, we did a bit more of the same, just the same model really, and then while that was going on, we did start working on wind, and we had an option to buy a 5 megawatts wind farm project that was in development just north of Bristol, and that started to take up a lot of our time. It was about a £10 million project. Unfortunately, we got involved with it about 12 months too late. And so, although we could talk to the local community about the community benefits, unfortunately, a NIMBY group had been doing that and fighting us or the project and putting out all that NIMBY propaganda for 12 months. And unfortunately, they got in there and did a very intimidating project, and also government policy started to change. And so by the time it got to planning, about 2 years later, it actually failed. So the writing was on the wall, really, so we had turned our minds back to solar, and we started to look for large-scale solar as well as roof-mounted solar. We had a few potential projects that didn't come off, but we kept going, because you've got to keep going. And then we ended up last October with our third fundraise. And this ended up being a fundraise for just over £10 million. And it was for a solar farm, two solar farms, and more community roof projects. So one of the solar farms was in Somerset, which was just being built out. The second solar farm was in Lawrence Weston, in Bristol, just down by the docks. That wasn't built out, didn't exist. And then obviously the community roof installations didn't exist either. The reason we ended up doing this amount so quickly was because the government was just slashing the feed-in tariff scheme to the extent that if we didn't get on and do these, they wouldn't be viable to do anymore. So there's a deadline pretty much of this June that's just gone. We needed to get these done by then, otherwise they weren't financially viable. So the good news is that we've done most of it. We purchased the solar farm in Puriton back in December. We built out the Lawrence Weston farm in Bristol. That was completed at the end of June, about 4 days before the deadline. So no pressure there at all. And on the roofs, we've done five, there's only one more to go. One of the saddest things with this project for me is that some of the roofs that we've been talking to, or the organisations we've been talking to for so long, when it came to it, they wouldn't go ahead and sign a 20-year lease, even though we'd given them all the benefits, whether it's financial, environmental, social, they wouldn't do it. They wouldn't take that jump. And it was so, so frustrating, because if those people won't do it, what are we going to do with the rest of the population who is still cynical? And so it was really annoying. The other thing I forgot to mention, actually, when I was talking about these projects, is the community benefit side. So we factored into our models, if everything runs as planned over the 25 years that these projects run, we aim to put £4 million back into community benefit. And we're also front-loading some of that. So once we've got all this final bit of fundraising done, we're looking to put £100,000 into community benefit up front. Otherwise, the money tends to get paid off to the banks first, and the communities often get the benefits only at the end of the project. So we've tried to deliberately front-load some of the community benefits. So how we raise that money, it's been quite a mixture, and it has been a challenge to do it in these time frames. We were never planning to do this so quickly, but thankfully to some commercial banks, so we've got Close Brothers and Triodos, who are obviously Bristol-based, who we have a good relationship with Bristol City Council, who have invested. They've also provided quite a few of the community roofs we installed on. There's a fund called Social and Sustainable Capital who helped out. We've also just had some top-up funding from Pure Leapfrog. And good old Joe Public. Yeah, we've managed to raise over £3.5 million from the public in shares and bond offers, bonds, and that's been tremendous. And we really want to build on that as we go forward. So I just want to talk about the Lawrence Weston solar farm in a bit more detail. I mean, in terms of its size, I think it's very much the same, pretty much the same size as Adams Westmill Solar Farm. So the difference really is it's right by the motorway. I mean, when you drive out of Bristol and you pass the big wind farms, on the right hand side, that's where our farm is. But actually, it's really, really close to the local community. Motorways tend to sort of cut communities in half, a bit like the M32 in Easton. But when you're in Lawrence Weston Community Centre, you can walk to that solar farm in 10 minutes. So that community, when you're in Lawrence Weston, you've got the wind turbines are huge, doing their things, you've got lots of industrial stuff all around, and they haven't had that much benefit from lots of these energy schemes in the past. But with this one, they will, because they're a big partner in this, and they're a recipient of the community benefit. And there's a group there called Ambition Lawrence Weston, which is a local group who are regenerating the area. They've got a 10-year regeneration plan for the area in terms of better jobs, better housing, community cohesion, better environmental stuff. And so we're working with them on this scheme. And They brought the scheme to our knowledge. It was in planning, and it's actually on council land, and the council were originally planning to do it themselves, the scheme themselves. But in the end, we managed to convince them to rent us the land, and we'd actually do the scheme ourselves, and we'd fund it ourselves. And we're very pleased that they said yes. It took a bit of persuasion, but it went ahead, and it's looking good. So those were the key partners, really, on the Lawrence Weston scheme: the council, who own the land, Ambition Lawrence Weston, the local community, And then the other two people, Mongoose Energy, which is a spin-off from Bath and West Community Energy, which is one of the biggest and most established community energy groups in the country. They've set up and are helping lots of community energy groups across the country to find schemes like this, to find the finance for it, to project manage the build-out, to help with long-going asset maintenance. Because for a local group to be doing this sort of stuff, it's far too technical for groups to be able to do it on their own. They need help. So Mongoose provide that expertise on a sort of turnkey basis. And they've been instrumental in helping us both find these projects, but also build them out to the timeframes we needed to do. And the other partner is FX, who you may be aware of, who is like a crowdfunding platform for social investment. So you might have a community pub or a community shop who need to raise funds. If you go onto their FX website, you can have your scheme on there and you can crowdfund and raise your money that way. So our projects were on that FX site. So that's what we've done so far. Like Adam said, it's been hard work. It's been ups and downs all the way along, and no doubt it always will be. But it's been particularly so in the last sort of 2 years, and everybody's watched sort of environmental policy just go up in flames in the last 18 months. So, what's happening? What's going to be with the future? Well, I think we have a choice, and what I think is good about community energy is our opportunity to educate the country about what is possible and educate them about energy literacy, I suppose. It sounds a bit airy-fairy, but this is what it's all about. You know, you get all the spin about keeping the lights on, you know, poor old taxpayers who mustn't spend too much on their energy and all this sort of stuff. But actually, this is the real stuff. So the choices are we going to keep going with dinosaur projects, dinosaur infrastructure, or are we going to adopt a strategy using nimble technologies which can adapt quickly and smart and can be rolled out very quickly? So, and this is my thought right now. This isn't necessarily energy our co-op's policy. We don't really have a policy on nuclear. But for me, why would we invest in Hinkley? Huge costs. Long time scales. Their reactor doesn't even work yet. They can't make it work in the other places they're building it. They've got no waste solution. And all the security issues. You know, every so often they blow up. Somebody might intentionally try to blow it up. We may have the Chinese remoting in and switching it off, taking it over. You know, huge, huge issues. And in contrast, we can go for proper large-scale energy efficiency. I read a report the other day. If we actually did our energy efficiency properly, we'd save so much carbon that we wouldn't need to be building Hinkley. It's that bigger thing we could be doing. You know, we could rapidly roll out, you know, the solar, wind, hydro, tidal, all the other ones as well. I mean, we built our solar farm in 3 months. That's how rapidly you can do this sort of stuff. I was in Germany over the summer, and just looking around, I would say 50% of the commercial roofs that I saw had solar on. I saw schemes where the houses produced 6 times more energy than they actually used. So all this stuff's out there, it's all doable. Energy storage is here now. It's not a thing for the future, it's here now. Smart grids, demand side management where companies or individuals reduce their use for a time period, whether you switch off your fridge or whatever. That's all here now. And locally distributed energy, you know, so we don't have these massive transmission losses as it comes down the line from a power station a long way away. So it's all there. This is all existing technology, and you've got lots of studies, whether it's from CAT or Greenpeace or even more recent ones, that all prove that we can do all this with existing technology. And this is really what it's coming down to, I think, that if you talk to your local MP, they probably don't know, actually. We spend an awful lot more money, or the government does, subsidising fossil fuels than we do renewables. Why? I mean, we know that probably 80% of known fossil fuels have to stay in the ground. We can't afford to use them because we'll go over our carbon budget. So why are we doing this? Sorry, I've maybe gone a little bit off track, I don't know, but this is it. If we can get these messages across, that we can do what we need to do to get what we need to get to, and we can do it now, and probably more cheaply, using existing technologies rather than go for these big infrastructure projects, then it's not exactly a job done, but hell, we could get a long way there. So that's where I'd like to get to, and we've just done our 10 million fundraise. What I'd like to be doing next is a much bigger one, where we are getting, say, the pension funds involved, a bit like you were talking about, sort of joining the forces. You know, the money's there, we just need to get our act together, I think. Thanks very much.
Well, Andy, that was such an encouraging story, because last year was the Green Capital Year here in Bristol, and one hasn't really heard very much about what is actually happening in the region. And, you know, your story is such an important story. I don't know whether, you know, have you been all the BBC West, and, you know, these are important stories, and I'm amazed that we are not hearing them other than in a conference like this. In fact, when you build on what Andy is just talking about, Andrew Clark, who unfortunately couldn't be here, but who's done similar, though mainly wind power projects in Gloucestershire, he's done a study for Molly Scott Cato for the Green Party, saying there's no problem at all powering the whole of the southwest of England with renewable energy at half the price of the Hinkley power, you know, the money that we would have to pay if Hinkley is implemented. It's just ridiculous that we are still in this sort of dinosaur age that you're talking about. And so great to hear your story. And now we're going to cross Peterhead's Severn Bridge into South Wales, because Robert Proctor is doing similar work in that part of the world. And we were just saying we're going to hold an event like this at Ebbervale or in Merthyr Tydfil, which are places where there used to be a very vigorous energy economy, but based on coal. But now there are hundreds of thousands of people stranded there without really an economy to speak of, and without significant jobs, you know, in the vicinity. So we want to really, together, because I live in South Wales too, we want to jointly initiate a process where these regions of South Wales can really benefit from renewable energy in a major way, rather than in a sort of add-on way. Well, Robert Proctor is Director of Community Energy Wales, a membership organisation which was set up to help to create the conditions to allow community energy projects to flourish. He's also the Director of the Climate Change Projects in South Wales and a project called Renew Wales. So over to you, Robert Proctor.
It's a pleasure to be here tonight, and I think Herbert described the panel here as pioneers. Well, I wouldn't probably describe myself as a pioneer in their company, but maybe I'm a pioneer with a small p, and I'm still quite young, so hopefully maybe in 5 or 10 years I'll be up here as a fully fledged pioneer. But I guess as Work of Community Energy Wales, what I represent are Welsh pioneering community energy projects, and it was actually those practitioners who set up Community Energy Wales to try and support and develop community energy and roll out community energy in Wales. We had a big conversation in Wales a couple of years ago. We asked the question, what does Wales want? What do we want our future to look like? I love this picture, but it'd be interesting to ask these guys what they thought the future would look like for the Welsh Valleys. As Herbie mentioned, you know, I think they'd be pretty disappointed. I think it's pretty, you know, it's pretty shameful the state that we've left, left those communities in, with very little employment, very little opportunity, lots of unemployment and other problems that go alongside that. You know, a lot of people made a lot of money from the coal industry, and barely any of that money stayed in those areas, wasn't invested in those communities. I think if we look back when coal was being being produced locally, perhaps this system did fulfill some of the needs of those communities. It provided reliable energy. It was affordable. People working in the mines often got free coal to heat their homes. It provided jobs, and it gave the communities a sense of identity and purpose. What little income they did make, they invested in their communities, and some of that infrastructure is still there today in the miners' institutes. The NHS was based on an initiative set up by some of those communities to invest in their local areas. But obviously, most of the money went elsewhere. It was dangerous work, it was dirty work, it was poorly paid, and now even more so, it looks like a dysfunctional system. It's carbon intensive, it's having massive impacts in terms of the climate, it's run by a powerful lobby of small organisations. The profits are not staying locally. The costs are going up. There's a huge amount of problems with fuel poverty in these areas. The homes that were built are poorly insulated. People are struggling to heat their homes. There's a lot of fuel poverty in those areas. And these people, yet again, are passengers of a dysfunctional system. We have a word in Welsh, twp, which means a stupid system. So I think we can, I don't think that's the future for our energy. Energy future. And in Wales, we've started the decarbonisation process. We've gone from the big six to the big wind. So we are, we're starting to replace some of the fossil fuel industry with wind energy. But again, it's run by the same people. It's not being reinvested back into the communities. We saw pictures of Penacamoy. A very small amount of that money is being reinvested in those local communities. Renewable energy is decentralised. We need a more horizontal structure so that more people benefit from that. What we need is people-centred solutions, and this is a picture from one of the first. Yep, Paul's probably on there. But it's one of the first community energy cooperatives in Wales, and another fantastic image along with some of the other images we've seen. So I want to give you an overview of what is happening in Wales, and it's not, in terms of community energy, it's not a particularly positive picture. People often think of Wales as a place that is leading the way on sustainable development, and people think that there's probably a lot more happening in community energy than there is, but unfortunately we have made a very, very slow start. There's been big problems around planning, as we've heard about, big problems with connecting to the grid, licensing, with NRD, Natural Resources Wales and the Environment Agency, as it was. Resources accessing land, but also the people who are doing most of this work are volunteers predominantly, and giving up their own time. And it's a massive challenge, as we've already heard. I think there was a joke made by a professor in Cardiff University who said, if you put all the main community energy practitioners in a minibus and drove off the edge of the cliff, that would be the end of community energy in Wales. Unfortunately, that possibly is not far off the truth. So I think one of my main roles is to make sure that not all those people are in the same place at any one time. So we've only actually got 2.5 megawatts of capacity installed. I think that's about 19 projects. By the end of this year, we hopefully will have around about 8 megawatts, and that's the legacy of those projects that have pre-accredited. So it's not a great story, although things are happening, and we've actually got something to show for all the efforts now. Over 5 million has been raised in the last 3 years in share offers, and there have been around 90 groups actually developing projects. So there is a lot of interest in this. It's just getting the projects off the ground and overcoming all those barriers. And now we've obviously got the additional barriers of the reductions in the feed-in tariff and the removal of tax relief. So we've heard all this before, but what do we need? We need a new smart grid. We need lots of clean energy sources. We shouldn't be reliant on importing fuel. We don't want to be making money for Ferraris, for Qataris. We want to keep that money local. We need to create opportunities for long-term jobs. We need to to help strengthen our communities. And that's actually something about the culture of Wales, particularly in Welsh-speaking areas, because people having to move out of those areas to get jobs. The language is dying in those areas. The culture is dying because people are having to move away. There's not enough jobs there, and that's a big incentive for a lot of communities in Wales when they're developing these projects. And we also need, local people need to see the benefits of that locally owned energy with cheaper bills, and we need to engage people. So I guess at the moment, with the reduction in feed-in tariffs, we've got this vision of a holy grail where you can actually, where you're able to buy your energy directly from local energy producers. And that doesn't happen at the moment. It's very, very, I wouldn't say it's impossible for it to happen, but it's very, very difficult for that to happen through Ofgem regulations, the regulations that we have. But an example of the benefits of that is Veltheim, which took over control of their local grid, and they're able to sell electricity to their citizens at 13 cents a unit, whereas Berliners, for comparison, pay 23 cents. So it is possible to have cheaper electricity as well, using renewable energy. We've actually got a really exciting trial happening up in North Wales in Bethesda, in partnership with an organisation called Energy Local. The members will pay only 8 pence a unit for every unit of energy that's generated by the local community-owned hydro power station. So they are buying the energy directly. And the great thing about that is they're paying almost half the price for the energy, but the generator is also getting that all of that 8 pence. So they're making much more from the money that they sell as well. And, you know, this surely is the future. This is what we should be striving to. And that, you know, we don't need fits, we don't need subsidies if we can make this happen. Just a little plug, we have got a conference coming up in Bethesda where we'll be learning more about this project. So I've put a link here. I don't know if the slides are going to be shared, but you can always come and speak to me. It would be great to see many of you up there to come and find out about this really exciting project. I know we're sort of going over in time, so I won't go into huge amounts of details, but these are some of the things that we're really working towards in Wales. This is our Community Energy Wales's manifesto, you know, that we've been, during the last Welsh Government elections, that we are trying to push and address. And I think it's fair to say Wales, in terms of policy, is actually quite good policy, generally. We've now got the Wellbeing of Future Generations Act. We've got a new Sustainable Wellbeing of Future Generations Commissioner, Sophie Howe, who seems, you know, willing to shake things up and challenge government on things. We've got a new environmental bill. We had a really interesting cross-party working group, the Environment Sustainability Committee, created a really innovative Smarter Energy for Wales document where they shared a vision. And Welsh Government are supporting community energy projects through a project called Ynni Lleol, which is local energy. So Welsh Government, you know, are quite supportive, although some would argue that perhaps Welsh Government can be accused of being all flagships and no ships, because a lot of the policy is very good, but then the practice on the ground doesn't actually live up to some of the better policy. And I think there's a lot of, you know, difference across the government as a whole. There's some very good departments and there's others very poor departments. And, you know, I guess our challenge is to really try and get all of the Welsh Government working towards this agenda. We also have a big problem with local authorities in Wales that are very risk averse, have not really been that supportive of community energy, really. Very few sort of examples that have. And a lot of powers obviously aren't devolved to Wales. You know, the Ofgem regulations aren't, the feed-in tariffs aren't, tax relief isn't. So, you know, there's issues that are outside of Wales's control. But I think one of the biggest issues is, you know, how do we engage people? Sure, you know, we come to events like this, we're all singing from the same hymn sheet, we all believe in the same things, and why can't we get that message across to other people? Why isn't everyone demanding this different energy future? So I've got a quote, hopefully this is going to work. I don't know if it is going to work, but I'll give it a try. If not, I'll have to sort of give the quote. But it's a quote from Alan Simpson, who was a former MP. He's turned community energy advocate, and I think he sums up the situation in Wales perfectly. We'll see. There we go. It didn't work. I'll give the quote myself. But basically, he said he's never been to a country that has the resources that Wales has that could really lead the way on community energy. And basically, what he says is that the reason, you know, if it doesn't happen, it's because not enough of us have stood up to make it happen and demand that change. And I think that's the challenge for all of us here today. We all believe, we're all committed to it, but we need to convince other people. We need to get a movement of of people that is much broader than this room to start seeing the benefits of community energy and the follies of things like Hinkley. And that's our real challenge, because unless we do that, then it's really difficult for us to put pressure on governments to change their policies. So yeah, that's it for me. And if you want to find out about any more of the events or the film that I failed to be able to show and have a look at it, then yeah, get in touch with me during the question time or after the event.
Well, so that's the end of what's been happening. What are you going to hear from this platform other than responding to questions and presentations from you? We've got another half an hour, 40 minutes or so to discuss the issues that have been raised here from the platform. So could you put up your hand and say something about what you would like to discuss? Who's going to go first? Okay. Thank you.
Peter Duras. My question is really just, should we ask some questions about the grid? I think you said something right at the end about Ofgem regulations. I know nothing about that. But, you know, does the grid... Sorry, I'm not close enough. Is the grid working backwards well enough for distributed energy? You know, the grid is still very much from the transmission downwards. The power companies are very resistant to large connections. There are many parts, I think in the West Country, where they won't allow connections. And are we, with the reduction of feeding tariffs, are we getting too little back? Is the actual payment from the power companies to supply? It's very low. Why is it so low, and how can it be?
Okay, so thank you, Peter. Very technical question. Who's the most technical person on this platform?
Okay, Rob.
I'm definitely not a grid expert, so I'll do my best. But certainly there is a massive issue in Wales and parts of the southwest. The grid is pretty much full to capacity. There's certain parts of Wales where you cannot develop projects unless you spend millions on upgrading the infrastructure, which isn't realistic for a community energy project. I think the interesting thing about the route we need to go down, I don't think we're going to have massive investment in the grid, is going to be looking at smart technology, battery storage, trying to use as much energy locally as possible. I think that's where the Bethesda project and other projects like that are quite interesting, because what they're doing is aggregating all the energy that's generated locally with what needs to be used locally. And again, I think what Peter was talking about, looking at household scale, about, you know, how can a household or a community manage its own energy needs more effectively. There are huge problems with the grid.
Thank you. Okay, who's next? Who's next? Let's hear your voices. Let's hear perspectives on this issue of really making community energy happen, because it's too slow, as we've heard, and there's a lot of expertise here to discuss this issue. Gentlemen up there.
I can say,
could you say who you are, please?
Sorry. I'm Martin Peck, I'm from Wales, so I'm a small organic hill farmer. Wendy's, towards the end of her talk, she went to the forest, the woodland forest that she, the community planted. I thought that was a very, very important issue, something that's close to my heart, but also I think it's something we have to bear in mind all the time when we're talking about energy, that we're looking after the planet Earth, which humanity has devastated to a huge extent. And I think part of our quest, or a major part of our quest, is to help nature recover. And so anything that we do in energy has to bear those things in mind. Right, there's so many very, very, very huge positive things come from this evening. It's been fantastic. But I want to say something which is possibly negative, and it's to do with solar panels on fields. Now, fields have have soil, and soil is very important. Now, in my area, I've seen people putting solar farms on grade 3 land, which has huge carbon sequestration potential. So now I understood, sorry for forgetting names, but the difficulty in persuading people, you getting people to put solar panels on their roofs, on etc. etc. So what do we do? I mean, I understand the problems, but even so, we have to bear in mind that that land has the potential to sequester carbon, and while we have so many buildings anyway, that was said earlier today somewhere, that we should be putting solar panels on roofs. Wind farms, totally in favour of. So can you say something, the land that you had your solar farms on, have you done any calculations about the balances between, you see where I'm coming from? Okay, thank you.
I wouldn't say they've done the calculations, but the locations of the farms, so they're both near the motorways. The grade of the land is quite poor, and the Lawrence Western one, we're literally still finishing it off. With the Puritan one, it is grazed. So yes, I understand there are some issues. We've tried to deal with those issues as best we can, but we still think it's better to be doing that than not doing it at all. And still, I think when you actually look, you know, if you get a train and you drive it, it's just watch out the windows as you go up north. There's so few solar farms, really, in relation to the extra amount of land we have, that I don't think we're quite getting to that stage of sort of saturation yet. And obviously, there's less sun in the north, so there's more, you know, you get more farms in the southwest. But you know, given that it's been so hard to do a wind farm, and you need to get on, I think it's probably better to be doing it than not doing it really. But yes, obviously we had lots of discussions about it internally as to whether we should be doing this or not.
Yeah, thanks Martin. As a farmer, I had that concern myself as well, and had it not been a community project, I wouldn't have gone ahead. Having said that, everything's a real compromise, so you're absolutely right. The wind turbines use up almost no land whatsoever, produce three times, in terms of land use, it's hugely much more electricity than the solar, but they're much less predictable than solar, and not everybody likes them, you know. And if we're going to be serious about reducing our getting more electricity, green electricity, we're going to have to need a lot more wind turbines, and that will change our landscape. I think it's a compromise. I think that's a real challenge. And I guess, you know, the sort of pros and cons is you can make them high biodiversity sites. That's part of the thing that's going on now. You can grow crops in amongst them. Certainly the way the angle works, if pushed into shove, you could do that. It's a challenge. Yeah, we graze sheep, we have grazed sheep, but that's sort of tokenistic, I think, in that sense. I think in terms of sequestration, it's also the whole issue that actually, I farm crops as well as livestock, and my farming, you know, isn't great in terms of carbon emissions. You know, I'm serious about reducing them, but it's also not great for the planet Earth either, I think, probably. You know, so I think everything is lots of shades and perspectives there, but fair point.
Yes, thanks, Martin. You just reminded me of a very important part of the story about Accra, is that the people in the slums, millions of people, are cooking using charcoal at the moment. And as soon as we introduce biogas, they will all stop using charcoal, which is a fantastic benefit in the cutting down of forests. So just a simple thing like using biogas can completely change the dynamic of the way forests are looked after in Ghana. So, you know, it's just thinking about everything as a system, as I said earlier.
Yes, everything is a compromise, absolutely. And I think where we're really inspired by the reforestation projects that come on, it's not just about improving biodiversity, but actually when you have more forests, and even in Chennai that has a little bit more trees, a few more trees than say in some of the parts in Mumbai, the effect that has on the local climate is not insignificant. And so, you know, I can be out in the field in the New Forest, and it can be you know, 35, 40 degrees, and you really feel it because there's no shelter, and I can go into the forest, and it could be 10 degrees lower in terms of its effect. It's not perfect. I mean, with the solar villages, we look at roof mounters, and also the demand for energy is a fifth of what it is here at the moment. We plan for development as well, looking at the numbers, but still the square metre of space that's going to be taken up is very, very little. And we hope that, you know, the whole point of convergence is we will reduce the amount of energy that we need, because there's still an awful lot of waste in the world. And we hope that in India they won't actually be as wasteful with their energy in some of these, you know, in some of these pilot projects that we're doing. We hope we can demonstrate that there are ways to actually use a little bit of energy that we have much more wisely. I think that's part of the solution too.
I think it's a really important point that you raised. We are certainly on a massive collision course between humanity and the world's ecosystems, and certainly energy use is part of that problem. I think when it comes to covering land with PV panels, the question obviously is how to go beyond tokenism in terms of grazing the land. I mean, I think geese might be even better candidates for grazing underneath solar panels than sheep, I don't know. But one issue that's not been raised yet is that we have huge subsidies across Europe and America for growing crops for producing methane gas. And the production of those crops takes up far more land than solar energy production from PV panels. So certainly reducing subsidies on producing methane gas from crops that are specially grown would be a major step in the right direction, and we would be making much more efficient use of land, covering some of that land with solar panels rather than with maize, especially growing as energy crops. So, next questions. Here at the front, Sue.
I worked a lot in Pakistan, and one thing we were looking at is reducing the heat in schools in Northwest Frontier Province. And of course, if you put solar on the roofs on raised frames, you're going to significantly reduce the heat input through the roofs, so you've got a double whammy. That's a very good thing. And I was thinking of Adams windmills, right? And I was wondering whether they change the Aeolian landscape above your farm. And I was thinking of, in, for instance, Scotland, we have huge wind damage now, where you're losing roofs a lot, where we never used to. A, because they're poorer roofs. B, because you've got idiot architects putting huge roof overhangs facing the valleys and lots. But are there knock-on impacts of, could we use banks of windmills to stop extreme storm impacts on winds on settlements? Can we reduce heat levels, whatever? Anyway, that's one question about those secondary impacts. But the other thing is, we haven't really mentioned storage in that revolution. We've got the battery revolution, but this new, has anybody seen Ares, A-R-E-S? You know, this idea of mass transport of trucks up and down valleys with concrete on them to create energy storage on a mass scale. Double pumped off-river hydro, which is really, we're looking at in Australia. Welsh valleys again. So, I mean, maybe if they're paying £3 million because they've got to turn the turbines off, maybe you could just be selling inertia up the Welsh valleys or double pumped hydros. I mean, there's huge new markets.
Any comments from here?
Only the wind turbines won't try and change the wind landscape around your buildings. But trees would. So trees actually can help with that, but not wind turbines.
I think Paul, do you want to say something? Paul Allen from the Centre for Alternative Technology, one of the hugely important
want to pioneer in another pioneering organisation to make such that.
Thank you very much for a fabulous array of stories, and even for me, it keeps my ear to the ground. There are still stories that I hadn't heard, stories that are quite moving, and I think we need to find ways of telling more of these stories to more people. I could imagine if we could bring in the makers of the Billy Elliot film and get them to do the stories of the community, and then the man at the back comes in and says something that turns everybody around and shows that sense of community empowerment. So I wonder if the panel can reflect on how we can tell more of stories out there to a wider number of people. Also, a more technical question, and the PowerPoint is going to be available, because I've scribbled some notes, but my handwriting's not very good, and it'd be really nice to have access to the PowerPoints.
On the video.
I think does anybody mind passing on presentations? No?
What about Peter? Would you mind sharing your presentation?
This resonance. Would you give a... What was it for?
Are you happy to share your presentation with
everybody?
So your
PowerPoint guide. Yes, of course I will. And I am not here, if you want. So I think yesterday they were here. I expected every presentation will be available.
Happy to share that.
Yeah, well, I would suggest that the organizers will go for it and feel hard and so on their homepage and maybe. Radical technology homepage and all the presentations made available there. Why not?
Yeah. Preben, have you got any other comments after this session?
Well, I have. You see, it's in our societies there's much focus on technology, and there's also spending much money on improved technology, also with the energy. But the future is not so much a matter of technology, it is that we find social models that is accepted for the people. So it's a social aspect here, how we now can have very high shares of renewable energy. And I presented an idea which is some what I would think would come after the feed-in tariffs, because feed-in tariffs can be taken some of the way, but there are some people that have to live with the wind turbines. They have to take, who has, let's say, the negative aspects of it should also have the positive. And this is why I have my presentation, but also in general, should be given an accept bonus. Accept bonus you could benefit from it anywhere, also in England, but it was, and could only be given to the communities in which the wind turbines are installed. An accept bonus, and then people have to be organized as community organizations with purposes for the common good. I think we have to decapitalize, especially the wind energy, because in most part of Europe today it's in the hands of people that see this as a way of making a profit. And there's nothing wrong about making profit, but once you've got access to a piece of land, you can gain big profits without making any efforts. It's not real business. Once, as the public, the authorities, they appoint a designated land for wind power, and you get a guaranteed price, then you can sit here and lean back for the next 20 years and collect the income. So it's not real business. So this is why who should benefit from it. That is the people in the communities. And we have the other issue, as mentioned earlier, is that if they don't accept, we don't have the wind power. We don't get it. We must have their acceptance. And in this way, we can also revitalize the local communities. And there we have a general movement. We have it in many countries, that people move to big cities and We don't have to take care of the economy of the big cities. That will just grow by itself. But Sam has to take care of the economy of the rural areas. We definitely have. And it's not a special Danish phenomenon. It's a European phenomenon. It certainly goes much wider. And here, and I think some of you also earlier could see that the change to renewable energy, especially the change to decentralized energy forms, could also be to the benefits of the people in the communities. And we have a principle saying that when we try to launch, when we have such meetings, saying that the wind belongs to the people where the wind is. But because we cannot monopolize the wind there, we cannot catch it. We have to say that the foundations of the wind turbines, which are going to catch the wind, has to be the property of the community. And not only for the few that can invest, but for the community as a whole. So that we make wind energy and solar energy also part of the infrastructure. Make part of the infrastructure of the local communities. Like the school, the kindergarten, the elderly, the home for old people. What we see is public infrastructure and needs of local people that renewable energy forms, such as wind and especially solar, also becomes part of the community. We have seen the brochure say it's part of individual houses, but it cannot be part of the community. This is my main point. And this has been seen from a Danish side. We've been the whole process there where we have had community ownership at the individual level, and then it was, and I think it was not happening intentionally, but this was the effect of it at least, that it's now mostly in the hands of private investors, and now we sit with the opposition at the local level, where people protest, and it's become a normal thing to protest. And I think it's really a big problem we have, that we all need, that we must change from the fossil fuels, must change from atomic energy and so on to the renewable energies, that is meeting far too much opposition from people. What we all see is important, what we all see is needed, must also find social models, must find kind of ownerships that in general is accepted by the people. That's my main.
Can I just pick up the point about stories? Because I think it's a lovely point. I just wonder whether actually anyone in the audience has any thoughts, because goodness, we all need, you know, positive stories nowadays. And you're right, when Andy was saying, you know, it's all volunteer time, which it is. And we're going to say that, you know, it's about the people, the love. It is that sort of softer stuff, which is very inspiring when you get to hear it. Unless you're there, you don't see it. But you're right, it'd be lovely. I don't know if there are any comments from the audience.
Let me just come back to that. And I'd just like to respond to Craven's point, which is a major systemic problem we have in this country is the incredible concentration of land ownership coming out of history. You know, the enclosures and land clearances led to a massive, massive concentration of feudal land ownership in this country, and quite a bit of this sort of NIMBYism in this country, resistance against renewable energy, particularly wind, is because there is a disconnect between the village and the local community and the local land around the village. And so until and unless local landowners would be willing, as Adam of course has been, to allow the financial yields from that development to accrue to the local community, we're going to have a job on our hands to do this. But in Wales, we have a somewhat different situation, particularly in the former valleys, mining valleys and so on, where a lot of the land is actually communally owned. And that's where I think we can make real progress in the years to come, in my view. But response to the point made by Adam.
Yeah. David.
Thanks, David. I'm David Saunders. This is a bit of story. I founded... Closer, further away? I can hear you. This is... Five years ago, I was looking at solar coming in. I went to Germany. I discovered that the cost of solar energy was a third over in Germany and what it was here, just at the time that we were introducing the feed-in tariff. I'd been to a conference in Bristol, and our council leader there was saying there's room for a gigawatt of solar on the roofs of Bristol. We produced a solar map, and as a little experiment, I started a co-op about the same time Andy was doing his, to put solar on ordinary people's roofs. Now, if you do a community energy project on a field, you're going to generate energy that goes into the grid, and you're going to get tons, threes, fourpence. But the people who buy it are going to pay full retail. And you know the way of reducing the retail cost of energy. Now, it turns out, if you put solar energy on people's roofs, as a community, not as an individual, not as a middle-class person buying the solar themselves, but the community says, we're going to put solar on our roofs. This is already happening in America with commercial groups doing it, Solar City. They say, we would like to sell you energy, can we use it to generate? It's a very simple story. So you put solar energy on people's roofs, and in our experiment, we relied on the feed-in tariff to pay for it. So we're able to give people free electricity. Now, and this is where the story is. The story is that we're in the middle, we're on the starter slopes of an energy revolution. And the energy revolution is that the cost of solar is coming down steadily, steadily, steadily. In 1975, the renewable groups weren't talking about solar because solar energy cost 100 times the cost of grid energy. You could only afford to put it on satellites because you can't get a gas boiler up there. So people were putting solar energy on, but the technology revolution brought the cost of solar down. And there was a time when I bought the disk drive for £600 and it had 40 megabytes on it. That same disk drive, the latest disk drive I bought, I should have paid £120 million for it, and it was like 190 quid at Mountain, so I bought two of them. And that's going to happen with solar. At the moment, 5 years ago, solar energy, we could just afford to put it on Hamilton House roof. Andy and me, we both got some, because the cost of the solar was £2,000 a kilowatt, and over 30 years it would generate £3,000 worth of electricity. Plus we'd get a feed-in tariff. But now the cost of the solar is like £500 a kilowatt, and you're still getting £3,000 worth of electricity. Do you see what I mean? And this cost of solar is going to halve one more time, and then it's going to halve one more time again. And in Chile, the government there, not offering any subsidies whatsoever, asked people, will you build solar farms and sell it to us? What price do you sell it to us? We're not going to give you any subsidy, we're not going to give you any land, we're not going to pay you for the technology, no feed-in tariff whatsoever. You build a solar farm, what will you sell us the electricity for? And the answer was tuppence a unit. Tuppence a unit for solar electricity. Not 16 pence, not even our current wholesale price for this, half the current wholesale price. If you start putting that on people's roofs and selling people electricity for tuppence for this unit, as will happen in the next few years, and the point is, communities own the roofs. We own our roofs. That's how you get community energy. Not by saying they've got to let us have the land, but saying we own the roofs, they're our roofs. You join a community energy co-op, you put solar on your own roofs, you sell it to yourself for next to nothing. And then storage, all the storage in the United Kingdom at the moment, if you took all our car batteries, that's 1 hour of storage. If you took our pumped water storage, that's 1 hour of storage. If you take our gas grid, it's a month. you're going to stop burning fossil fuels at some point, we're going to stop burning gas, we're going to stop burning methane, and then we've got an empty gas tank. What do you fill it with? Hydrogen. How do you get the hydrogen from your excess solar? And this was written up in the same time as the books that we're being discussing today. 1975 was the year that the solar hydrogen economy was launched. And it's never taken off because electricity has never been cheap enough to make hydrogen cheaper than natural gas. But with cheap electricity, you can make them. So this will come up in the next 4 years, but you can already see this. Every year, if you go to Germany, there's a massive call about the solar economy. And in South Korea, they've ordered 13,000 hydrogen fuel buses so they can have pollution-free public transport. We can do the same. And this is the story that's going to unfold in 5 to 10 years. How do I know that? Because the amount of solar multiplies by 10 every 6 to 8 years. By 10 every 6 to 8 years. And where are we at the moment? We've already passed 1% of world energy from solar. 6 to 8 years in 2014. So by 2020, 10% of world electricity from solar. By 2028, not waiting until 2030, 100% of world electricity from solar. Unstoppable. That's what technology revolutions are like. And I think that's the story we need to be telling.
Right. Thank you very much. Now, I need to raise a question for Godfrey Peter. How long have you got here this evening in this room?
I think we should wind up pretty soon.
Wind up pretty soon is what Godfrey says.
Okay, so...
Should we have one more short question? How many of you call it? And then we'll have a final comment from the platform.
Okay, we have a quick one about land use. On my journey here from Brighton, I passed hundreds of acres of what to me is the most depressing land use of all. Airport car parks. Yeah. What do the panel think about these as sites for solar farms, and is there anywhere communities could get involved in that rather than large corporations?
Very good question, excellent question, because airports are shopping places when it comes to total dependence on fossil fuels. Any comments, responses to that question from the platform? I think we agree with you, we need to have a really major push in that direction. Peter?
Well, of course, it also provides shading for the cows, which is what we just heard about. And it is happening in other parts of the world, so absolutely, definitely it could happen, I think. And we should get on with it, because I think it would be a very logical thing to do.
Great. Okay, so final sentences rather than paragraphs from everybody up here. Robert.
I agree with Paul, we need to tell more stories and get out there. It's too technical for the ordinary people. I think they need to hear the positive stories that come from people like these people.
Yeah, I agree with the story. I think we have to get much better with our social media, work more closely with an organisation like 1010. I suppose if you look at Brexit, there's a few key messages, you keep pushing it hard enough, long enough, and eventually it starts getting through, I think.
We need renewable energy, especially in places like India, but we need a more holistic approach to how we integrate that and dovetail that with everything else. And I'll still say more trees, it's not radical, and it's much more cost effective.
I guess, following on from that, it is different, not just generating electricity, but actually reducing our uses is obviously key, which is part of what's going to be very key.
Yeah, I think basically we need large-scale demonstration of this in the UK. Some places have got to put their hands up and do it. Bristol, I tried very hard. Bristol doesn't seem to be willing to do it. Oxford, I would have thought would have done it, and doesn't seem to be willing. But Monmouthshire, I think might, and I think one or two places in Scotland might. I think if we just do it in one big region of the UK, everyone will follow once they see how amazing it is.
Yeah, thank you for the invitation, and I will take the opportunity to advertise this book we published last year, Light Over Africa. We have installed lighting in about 300 schools in Uganda, Burkina Faso, and Mali. And we have a plan here that for £10 million we can make in 10,000 more schools, and in this way serve 2 million people, most of them women who are in these rural areas. 90% of the women are illiterates, and this gives them the opportunity to read and write. And in addition, the Mali Quality Center, which is especially successful, they have, as part of this program here, made solar electricity to 80,000 families in Mali, where only 7% of the population used to have electricity, and the rural areas virtually none. So this is a good beginning, as I see it.
Thank you.
Well, I think we've had a really, really interesting evening. I'm delighted that all our speakers were able to come and join us here today. And so wonderful that we were able to really get in deeply into the issue of community energy. I think stuff will happen from this meeting. Robert and I will organise meetings in Wales. Others will do so in Bristol, or of course in Denmark too, or in Oxfordshire, or in India. So certainly we are all activists in one way or another, and sure something will come out of this evening here, as well as the conference as a whole. Every speaker at this event is getting a record that Artist Project Earth produced, which is really nice.